Hello, Malty Magic Masks of Malpractice, and thank you to Alec K for that not mentioned introduction to Ralfy Review 871 Extras. See the X you see for extras, in which I give additional perspective, opinion, experience, occasional rants as regards my recent reviews of specific whiskies. And recent, I've just finished reviewing some Chivas Regal 18-year-old Gold Signature, it's called. What a nice name. It's a signature. It's individual. It's gold. Must be good. And this is all about the super branding that goes on with Scotch blended whiskies, which are very much the bread and butter income for many large Scotch whisky companies. However, for other Scotch whisky companies, the sale of blended Scotch whisky is utterly irrelevant, because everything they're producing is single malt, because that is the market internationally that is really growing now. I know how times change. It used to be that single malts were rare, few and far between, and limited in availability and choice. But the Scotch whisky industry is now catching up with the fact that all of a sudden, and I know the internet's got a lot to do with it, but in a very short space of time, in the matter of two decades, international tastes have changed to such an extent that whisky fans are primarily buying single malt whiskies, which are more available, more diverse, more recognisable compared to a few years ago. Certainly more desirable. There's a higher premium on them. People are willing to pay more for the good ones. My goodness, you see that at auction. After all, when you hear all about the world's records for a bottle of Scotch whisky, it's always single malts, isn't it? It's never blends. Sure, there's some 50-year-old blended brands out there, but they have a brief flurry of marketing activity and then they're gone. And then they rarely get mentioned again, because the real money is in single malts. And this creates a problem for the brand, big brand blended whiskey producers, because their market is a consumer market that needs to be constantly poked and prodded to be reminded about the brands they should be aspiring to, without having to think too much about what they're doing. And that's the purpose of marketing. So you have a situation that a lot of money is being spent, but due to a global pandemic in 2020/2021, people are just not getting out to the shops the way they used to. People are certainly not getting into bars. There's no weddings, there's no funeral receptions. All the places that blended whiskey used to be consumed are really being put on hold due to pandemic global lockdowns. Although, of course, not every country in the world is having a lockdown. That's the fact of it. But this has severely impacted on blended whisky sales. And I'm just pointing at the Chivas Regal as an example of a blended Scotch whisky, not necessarily one that's being impacted by a lack of sales globally, although it's quite probable. And in the meantime, with the advent on online sales where bottles can be bought and either personally delivered or delivered by courier or delivered by post, people are buying more and more single malts. They're staying at home, they are drinking less volume and drinking more quality. And people, many whiskey fans have started with blends. And they've mixed in with the ice and the Coca-Cola, but they're not, to be honest, very few single malt drinkers are actually turning their single malt into fancy cocktails, punches, whiskey macs and whiskey sours, soda, Coca-Cola. The majority of single malt drinkers are buying their whiskey and putting it in a glass like this, a glass for sipping. This is why you, when you see all the pictures online, particularly from genuine fans, they like to show pictures on Instagram and on Twitter and on the forums with a snifter glass, either a Glencairn or a Capita. Not with a big chunky tumbler with loads of ice in it. You'll see that now and again when people want the novelty of an option and a change. But 90% of the time, people are smelling and tasting and getting educated about what they're drinking. And then something interesting happens, malt mates. Someone, even after a year and a half, a very short apprenticeship, will be out of curiosity, go back to a blended whiskey after the single malts and discover the shock that although the whiskey, the blended whiskey, hasn't changed much, their palate has. Our palates do. They change a lot. And what we were tasting and tolerating in the old days, chill filtered and basic minimum strength, no longer has the same appeal to us now as it did then. We're growing up and we're going out and we're looking at all these distilleries around the world now who are creating, no, not blended whiskies. They're not tub thumping and evangelizing about their blended whiskey. They're featuring and promoting and presenting their single malt, and with emphasis on its singularity. And this trend is going to dramatically continue, which is why when new distilleries like Torrevieg and Arnamurkin, got that right, appear, as they have just done in 2021, and there's more on their way, people are immediately buying with confidence and in good faith and are being rewarded for the fact that they've done their soundings online and they have confidence in the calibre of the experience in relation to the name and the brand that's presenting it. And it just happens to be single malt. People are tolerating. In fact, some people are enjoying the diversity of all these cask finishes and presentations. Although some folk quite rightly do have their suspicions that they can be used to mask over an inferior previous cask. Yeah, sure, it happens. But if the casks are doing the homework, if they are getting their calibrations right, if they're getting a good quality cask to do that cask finish, that secondary maturation, and if it works, and it can work, and it does work often, then mission accomplished. Fans will enjoy it. They'll enjoy the port cask matured version, the Sauternes version, the Chateau de Kem version, the Tawny Port version, the white wine version, the red wine version, the bourbon version, the virgin cask version, the sherry version, the Marsala version, the Madeira version, the whatever you want version, within reason. It's all happening right now. And in a very short space of time. Where does it go from here? Well, I think that the trend for good quality single malts will continue. That the distilleries who have, particularly who have the experience and the skills, the personal skill set to get the coordinates right in what they produce and have this simple plan without heavy-handed marketing of presenting what they've got to the world, they're going to get lucky, they're going to get the custom, they're going to get the loyalty. Meanwhile, we're going to see a few blended Scotch whiskies continue to disappear. Now, I miss some of the blended whiskies that I enjoyed in the old days, and the old days are not that old, like Bailey Nicol Jarvie, like old bottles of antiquary, some of the slightly eccentric blended whiskies, like Six Isles. It was a vatted malt. I actually quite enjoyed that. Even Dew of Benevis, which was an in-house recasked blend of grain whiskey and malt whiskey made at the same distillery. It's a curiosity, but I was looking out for it and quite enjoyed it. It wasn't spectacular, but it was interesting. But they're gone now. And now you have well-known blends like Black Bottle, for example, or Teachers, which is another really good example, where the flavour is frankly unrecognisable to what it was 10 years ago because they've changed the recipe. Simple reason. They've changed the recipe. That's one reason why they changed the branding, because they changed the flavour and they needed to have a clean break to avoid confusion. And you'll notice this for yourself when you get a bottle of modern blend, which isn't that expensive, and go to the auctions and get an old one from the 1980s, even the 1990s. And then you will have one of your most memorable whiskey moments in your private personal whiskey space, when you actually sit them side by side and see for yourself just what a difference there is. That pattern is leading to the downsizing of expectations amongst single malt whiskey drinkers of what to expect from Scotch blended whiskey. Tell me I'm wrong. And finally, just to remind you, I think I mentioned this before, I'm sure I have, but there is this saying that comes out from within the industry that single malts wouldn't exist without the reputation of blended Scotch whiskey in the first place. And that statement is made to try and piggyback on the reputation now of single malt whiskies, with their flavour and character and identity and the fullness of the experience, and to try and apply it to blended Scotch whiskey. And I totally disagree with that statement. In fact, I would counter by saying that in fact a Scotch blended whiskey wouldn't be anywhere on the map without the singularity, the quality, the identity, and in particular the flavours of single malt whiskey, which made Scotch blended whiskey what it was, what it can be. But nowadays, in my opinion, it's less than what it was. Malt mates, tell me I'm wrong. Because when I see all the conversation happening online, it's over 95% conversation about single malts, not about blended whiskey. Honestly, the way things are going online, unless it's a bought and paid for whiskey presenter who's been sent the samples and getting the plaudits and the pat on the back from the brand ambassadors, it's rare now that blended whiskies even get reviewed in whiskey channels. You've got to look up for yourself. I'm Ralphie in the Bothy, and by the way, I bought this. It won't be going to waste. I'm sure when I come to presenting you a nice upmarket whiskey cocktail, which, yeah, I accept the challenge. I will do that at some point, just for some fun. I have a whiskey in standby to use for that purpose. Yeah, there you have it.